Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 19th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have apologies today from the convener, Kirkab Stewart, and Paul O'Kane. But Kevin Stewart is attending our meeting as a substitute for the convener. Welcome, Kevin, to the meeting. Karen Adam and Megan Gallagher are also attending the meeting virtually today. Our first item on the agenda is to invite Kevin Stewart to declare any relevant interests.
I have no relevant interests, convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Kevin. Our second agenda item today for consideration is an affirmative instrument, and this is for the Draft Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland No. 4 Regulations 2023. And for this, I welcome to the meeting Siobhan Brown, Minister for Victims and Community Safety, and her officials, Shona Urquhart, Legal Aid Policy Lead, and Martin Brown, Solicitor Legal Directorate from the Scottish Government. You are all very welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning. I refer members to Paper 1 for this item, and I invite the Minister to say a few words about this instrument.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, Committee. Thank you for the opportunity to speak to the Committee about the Legal Aid and Advice and Assistance Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland No. 4 Regulations 2023. This instrument has been brought forward to deliver changes to existing legal aid regulations, primarily to ensure continuing access to justice in Scotland. This instrument makes provision to ensure that legal advice and assistance will be available to persons arrested under Section 27 of the National Security Act 2023, known as the 2023 Act Section 27, and the Schedule 6 of the 2023 Act will, if commenced, create a procedural framework for the arrest of a person reasonably suspected to be involved in foreign power threat activity. Current provision for legal advice and assistance does not cover all the circumstances of detention in relation to such activity, and these regulations will make further provision to ensure that an appropriate regime is in place to ensure that advice and assistance by way of representation can be provided to persons arrested under these provisions in the 2023 Act. Without additional provision, there is a risk that persons are arrested under the 2023 Act and are unable to access legal advice, assistance or representation. Similar provision is already in place for those detained under the anti-terrorism legislation. This instrument will also make provision for any carer support payment to be disregarded by the Scottish Legal Aid Board when assessing a person's financial eligibility for civil legal aid or children's legal assistance, and for such payments to be excluded from the recovery where a person has a liability to the Scottish Legal Aid Fund in relation to the civil legal aid proceedings. Carer support payment is intended to improve outcomes for unpaid carers by providing financial assistance to those providing regular and substantial care to someone in receipt of a qualifying disability benefit. Finally, the instrument makes minor amendments and corrections to regulations relating to council fees in respect of the civil and criminal legal aid. Convener, that's just a brief overview of the regulations and their context, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. Colleagues, do you have any questions or comments? Nothing. Just one from me. For the carer support payment, obviously this instrument makes the provision for those payments to be disregarded. Is it your expectation that they will always be disregarded by the Legal Aid Board?
I might bring in Martin for that one.
My understanding is that would be expected. Right. I think that's a policy question, but I expect that will be done. It mirrors the way that we've disregarded these, mirrors the way that other payments have been disregarded to ensure that they're not counted for your eligibility.
Okay, and that would be, there would be communication and clear information available to people about that, so they would know.
Yeah, I think that will be a question for the Legal Aid Board.
It would be expected that the people that qualify for this payment would always be eligible for legal aid. So it means that from an administration side of things for the Scottish Legal Aid Board, mm-hmm. they can just simply disregard it. They don't have to include it. Okay. But people that are receiving the payment would qualify anyway.
Okay. Thank you, Shona. That's helpful. Any other questions or comments from anyone? No? And just to let folk know, Fulton McGregor has joined us online. He was unable to get here because of train issues, but he is online at the moment. If there are no other questions, can I thank the Minister very much for that? Can we move straight to item three then, which is the formal business in relation to these instruments? And I ask the Minister to move the motion.
I move the motion.
OK. Any other final comments or questions from any member? No, nothing online. So are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for that. I invite the committee to agree to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations this morning on the affirmative SSI that we have just considered. Are we happy with that? Are we all agreed?
Yeah,
agreed. That completes consideration of the affirmative instrument. I thank the Minister and her officials for joining us this morning, and there'll be a short pause while we change over witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that. And we can now move on to our next item on our agenda today, which is to begin taking evidence on the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill. And I welcome our second panel this morning. We have Vicky Crichton, the Secretariat from the Scottish Legal Complaints Commissioner Consumer Panel, Sharon Horvitz, Legal Director from Competition and Markets Authority, Tracy Riley, Head of Consumer Markets, Consumer Scotland, and Dr. Marcia Scott, Chief Executive Officer from Scottish Women's Aid. You're all very welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning. I refer members to papers 2 and 3 in your packs. I'm going to invite the witnesses each to make a short opening statement, and I will start, Vicky, with you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, everyone. I'm Vicky Crichton. I'm Director of Public Policy at the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. But in that role, I provide the secretariat to the panel, the Independent Consumer Panel, and so today I'm here representing their views. The Scottish Legal Complaints Commission's Consumer Panel is an independent advisory panel which was set up in 2015 to assist the SLCC in understanding and taking account of the interests of consumers. Its remit involves providing feedback to the SLCC, from a consumer viewpoint, and that includes making recommendations on how the SLCC can improve its policies and procedures in relation to legal complaints, suggesting topics for research connected to legal consumers, and expressing a view on matters related to consumer complaints. The panel's members include representatives from Citizens Advice Scotland, the Competition and Markets Authority, Consumer Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid, Which, Young Scot, and representatives from academia. As many of those organisations are represented in their own right on the panel today, the panel's asked me to present its collective and shared views. The panel wants to see a regulatory system that puts consumer interests at its heart, that seeks to promote consumer confidence and to protect consumers, particularly those who might be more vulnerable from risk or detriment. Its views on regulation of legal services are in the aim of achieving those outcomes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vicky. Can I move now on to Sharon?
Thank you, Convener, and to the committee for the opportunity to allow me to come here today to set out the Competition and Markets Authority's views on the bill. So, Convener, the role of the CMA is to help people, businesses and the UK economy by promoting competition, promoting competitive markets and tackling unfair behaviour. The CMA has significant experience in working in the legal services sector, including various market studies and reviews across the UK as a whole. And this work includes the research report that we published in 2020 on the Scottish legal services sector, which followed the Roberton Review, the independent review, and was intended to support the Scottish Government's as it considered how to implement the recommendations from that report. We've continued our work in this area, notably responding to the Scottish Government's consultation prior to the bill's introduction and the call for views that followed it. In summary, we'd like to make three main points to the Bill Committee today. First, we welcome and agree that regulatory reform was required, and there are many aspects of the proposed bill that have the potential to deliver improvements for consumers in Scotland. However, we want to use this opportunity to reassert one of the main findings of our work, namely that the optimal regulatory model, a model where the regulator is truly independent of the representative bodies, is in our view the most effective way of achieving and maintaining the best outcome for consumers through the protection of consumer interests and the promotion of competition as well as wider public interest issues. It's also consistent with better regulation principles, and it avoids the risk that regulatory decision making may be compromised by the potentially opposing interests of the profession. And that's because there's a fundamental tension between the aims of the roles of the regulator and the professional body. And we believe that the bill is a missed opportunity in that regard. Although we have concerns with the current model, we do acknowledge that the government has proposed some checks and balances aimed at trying to ensure that the regulators exercise their regulatory functions appropriately, and those are included under sections 19 and 20, and they're the provisions that allow the CMA, Consumer Scotland and the Scottish Parliament to refer regulatory failures to Scottish ministers. However, the CMA has questions about how this oversight role would operate in practice and how effective a safeguard it might provide. For the CMA's part, our remit is cross-economy, and our decisions about what markets to examine and when is discretionary, informed by where we think we can deliver the best outcomes. And there is a risk of tension if the CMA is given a public role under legislation that requires ongoing monitoring. Thirdly, we consider that preserving the profession's independence from government is an important aspect of independence, important for securing various public interest considerations, such as protecting the legal rights of individuals and ensuring access to justice. The CMA believes that under the regulatory arrangements proposed in the bill, the Scottish Government has a more significant role than would be the case with an independent regulator. That's all I wish to say, but I'm very happy and willing to explore these issues further with the committee.
Thank you very much, Sharon. Tracy, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Consumer Scotland is a non-ministerial body which was set up a little over a year ago, and our role is to advocate for the interests of consumers. We think the legal services market is a very important one for consumers because gaining access to legal services can help them obtain redress across a range of other markets. The way that legal services are regulated and delivered can affect how consumers experience that market. Having services that are designed in a more inclusive way can help manage any risks that there are to consumers. We think the bill addresses a range of important public and consumer interest considerations. We particularly welcome the regulatory objectives being set out in primary legislation, and in particular, the consumer principles which are now set out on the face of the bill. We'd like to see the new regulatory framework applied so that it delivers tangible improvements for consumers. And in that regard, we think it's important that the ongoing impact of the reforms is monitored so that we can understand whether the market is actually meeting consumer needs, whether the regulatory framework is promoting opportunities for better outcomes and minimising any risks of consumer harm. We believe there would be both significant public interest and consumer benefit in a system of independent regulation. That being said, we do also believe that the bill represents a step forward from the status quo, and we think co-regulation can be made to work. It is the case that co-regulation will result in a system which might be relatively complicated for consumers to navigate, and that in turn requires further checks and balances to be in place to secure consumer confidence. Again, in that regard, we acknowledge the proposed ministerial powers of intervention in the market are the subject of strong stakeholder views, but we do believe some oversight provision is necessary because of the model chosen. In the event that an independent regulatory model had been chosen, we think it's probably unlikely that these powers would have been required. In relation to other aspects of the bill, we support the move towards entity regulation and the provision for alternative business structures. We generally welcome all the proposed changes to the complaints system, and no doubt I'll look forward to sharing further views on the detail of the bill as the session progresses.
Thank you very much, Tracy. And Marsha, over to you.
Good morning, everybody. Really welcoming and marking for myself the milestone of this discussion, I suppose. And I'll just sketch out for you why. And that's because Scottish Women's Aid, well, first of all, I guess this, we're a national domestic abuse organization. If you're not familiar with us, we're an umbrella for 34 services from Shetland to Dunoon to the borders. We establish and learn from the feedback loops that we enable and nurture with consumers, service users, and staff who work in grassroots organizations around Scotland. When I came into post 8 years ago, I did a tour of the 34 services, which took me far longer than I thought it would, I have to say, in part because of the delightful geography of Scotland. And my first question to the managers in those services was, what are the two biggest issues that the women and children that you work with are dealing with, and what are the barriers you have in supporting them? And I don't think the first answer will come as any surprise. Stable funding was, of course, the first problem for all of them, and that's a different committee meeting. But the second one, and this was unanimous around the network, was the problem with legal services for women and children. The multiple dysfunction in the system, the criminal and civil justice systems, that meant that women rarely and children rarely had access to their human rights for access to justice. The Scottish government and the larger legal situation, the larger legal context, very rarely enabled women to enjoy the rights that the government has, and through the UK state, committed to under international mechanisms. So it's been very clearly a long process for us to try and figure out how to change the system. And the regulation of legal services is one small but very important part from our perspective. And we engaged with the independent review of legal aid and also the independent review of the regulation of legal services, the Robertson review, Martin Evans' work, in our attempts to try and shake the foundations of some of the assumptions going into the way justice is not delivered in Scotland for women and children living with domestic abuse. One of the things that we have done as part of that is to test a new model for legal services, which we had to have privately funded because it was so difficult to to challenge the way services are provided in Scotland. And the Legal Education Foundation funded a series of projects for us, one of which delivered services in a new model at Edinburgh Women's Aid, which I'm delighted to say the Scottish Government has now committed to extending for 3 years as we look at the new model. And the features of the new model cross over with the discussions at hand here in many ways. But probably the most important feature, I think, is that we are looking at a model that works from a human rights perspective rather than a consumer model. And while I really will probably agree with everything that that my colleagues to the left say, I think it's really a mistake to think about access to justice as a consumer product. In fact, the way legal aid is set up in Scotland, women who are experiencing domestic abuse, 90%+ of them who experience financial abuse are still subject to a means test for legal aid. And when they do succeed at legal aid, at getting legal aid, it's only for a patchwork of some of the legal needs that they have. So our model would look at, our model does look at associating, as Martin Evans suggested, a family law specialist solicitor with an advice agency like Women's Aid, and one of the big barriers to setting up that model for us was the fact that the regulation against advice agencies like Women's Aid and advocacy organizations. Being able to just directly address the problems in service by hiring solicitors and providing a one-stop shop, so to speak, of both support and services for women and children. So we really welcome the proposal in this bill to change that situation so that certain organizations like our own could, in fact, more directly support women by hiring solicitors, as we have had to go through quite a lot of expensive hoops in order to manage just providing a service in Edinburgh Women's Aid. There are some aspects of the bill around that issue that we would take issue with, and happy to discuss that in more detail later. But I do think that I would really welcome the committee's consideration of the fact that this is an area that has been heavily influenced by vested interests for many years in Scotland. And this is a real opportunity from our perspective to begin to try and pivot Scotland in the direction of a justice system that actually delivers the human rights that women and children expect they should have and rarely do. And part of the reason why this is so important in a civil setting is that the way the system operates now has an enormously chilling effect on women's likelihood of calling the police, of engaging with the criminal justice system, because the civil justice system treats them so badly. So I would really welcome many aspects of the bill where, you know, we're concerned about the decision of the government not to go with an independent regulator. I'm happy to get into the details of all of that. But I just wanted to take this opportunity to say, well, the system is very much broken from our perspective, but there are seeds of innovation that seem to be growing initially, and that some of the innovations in this bill, if not passed, will possibly make the growth of a new system almost impossible. So thanks.
Thank you very much, Marcia. Thank you all for that. We'll move to questions and I'll come to my colleagues in turn, but just to kick things off, and maybe I'll stay with you, Marcia, if that's okay. You talked about some of that chilling effect that the way the current system works has. Could you just unpick that a little bit and say a little bit more about the specific issues that women and children in particular have in accessing the legal system?
Absolutely. So the by far probably the biggest violation of human rights in the way our civil justice system works is the what happens with women who are involved in the criminal justice system who have children. So one of the critical aspects that we know of is that when women consider whether to seek help, whether it's through calling the police or through talking to a social worker or through whatever mechanism, they are afraid, for good reason, that child protection processes will get involved that will mean that they may in fact wind up being tasked with failure to protect their children rather than being offered the resources of the system to help them protect their children by managing the dangerous behavior of the perpetrator, or the accused in this case. What that looks like in terms of legal services is that women, by the time women might actually go through a criminal justice process, there may well be, in fact, be a conviction and in the criminal courts. But by the time there's a consideration of child contact and custody and visitation questions in a civil setting, that process can happen completely disconnected from the criminal process. And so women are then placed in a situation where they are often not able to access legal services at any point in all of this. And I'll just say that the lack of access to any lawyer, legal aid or otherwise, at the moment in vast swathes of Scotland is extraordinary. And we've had accounts from Grampian, from Shetland and Orkney, from a variety of mostly rural but not entirely rural services, about staff trying making 50 calls to try and find a solicitor, legal aid or otherwise. So the system is, you know, it is really a crisis at the moment. But even, even should a woman get some advice for some elements of what's happening to her, and this is almost always civil legal advice, finding a lawyer who can give her advice is difficult, first of all. But secondly, by the time she gets that and it goes through the process, if she does find one, she's often enmeshed in processes in court that had she had the advice at the beginning, she would never have gone near. And that's what our new model tests, which is the minute a woman accesses support, does she have legal issues? Does she have legal questions? And I'll quote the head solicitor in Edinburgh Women's Aid, Gillian Baker, who says, you know, she says her biggest job is keeping women out of court, you know, and explaining to them when they don't need to and shouldn't engage with certain court processes. But the difficulty is that the advice that women get, first of all, it's difficult to find it. Secondly, when they do find it, it is very rarely domestic abuse competent or readily available and affordable for the solicitor to provide, and certainly not affordable for the victims that we work with. So providing a free at the point of need service is the model that we think needs to be tested.
Okay, thanks very much.
Sorry, Marcia. That was long.
No, that's okay. Kevin, did you want to come in on that?
Yes, convener. Welcome to the panel today. And I'd like to follow up on some of the comments that Dr. Scott has just made, in particular that statement that at points your folks on the ground are phoning up 40, 50 solicitors. So obviously there is going to be some advantage to charities to be able to directly employ legal professionals. Do you think, Dr. Scott, that there may be difficulties in some regards from certain quarters if charities are using the same solicitors again and again and again? And how do we get over that in terms of building up trust between those solicitors that are employed by charities and the woman in your case that you're representing?
I'm not really sure what you're concerned about here. I mean, I think, first of all, the fact that there's a solicitor associated with a particular service, I would think would build trust rather than challenge it. Is it other elements of the system that you're worried about in terms of the...
I'm playing devil's advocate here, and I'm actually thinking of a particular case that I was involved in many, 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 many years ago, where an individual thought that a solicitor was being thrust upon them, if you like. And if there is somebody associated with a particular charity, how are you going to deal with the situations where some folk, some women, may not actually want to use that solicitor? How do you get around that? Does that go back to the 50 calls or what can we do to build up that trust?
Well, I mean, having spent a lot of time in women's aid services, I find the scenario that you've just painted quite hard to associate with how I know services are provided.
Sure.
First of all, no woman or child in our services has services thrust upon them. Our problem is finding the services they need, more likely.
Sure.
If a woman accessed a service in this model and wanted legal representation and for whatever reason was not happy with the solicitor or solicitors who were available through Women's Aid, of course she would be supported to access legal aid or you know whatever the system offers her under those circumstances. And I'm sure, given our experience in Edinburgh, where one full-time solicitor wasn't even close to enough, it would be a relief to the system if a woman had another solicitor and could access her.
I told you I was playing devil's advocate, Dr. Scott, as you know from previous encounters, I always do. That scenario that you paint of one solicitor not being enough for Women's Aid here in Edinburgh, is there the opportunity between the 34 organisations that you represent to have a pool of folk so that there is choice there for women who may not want to go to one particular solicitor for whatever reason?
I think we're really unclear yet what we would be able to offer. I think that's absolutely a possibility. We're actually meeting with the Legal Education Foundation this afternoon as we've made it through a second tier application to pull together staff and survivors in some of the more rural areas to talk about what a model would look like for them because unlike in Edinburgh, I don't think one full-time solicitor would necessarily be needed in all of, you know, we have very small services. However, the geographical challenges, we don't know what the best model would be there. So we're trying to pull together a piece of work that would be funded there. But the other thing that we've suggested to the Access to Justice officials, given this problem with just finding any solicitor, is an additional solicitor funded through the program in Edinburgh Women's Aid in order to at least provide telephone advice. The other thing is that the Scottish Legal Aid Board is working with us to do a brief intervention to try and to help services access where there might be an available solicitor, but also to get really good data about where the worst problems are. And so we'll have more information as we develop the model. I'm not convinced that a Central Belt model is appropriate in other areas of Scotland. But sorry, that was a long-winded answer to say what you suggest would certainly be a possibility.
Not a long-winded answer at all, I would say. And I think you're right to highlight that for what may work in some of the larger cities may not work elsewhere. I'm very interested in terms of what you've had to say there around about telephone advice access. Again, you know, having experienced cases where some people that I've been dealing with have found it very, very difficult to access a solicitor at all. I think that telephone line as a last resort is probably a good one. Have you had any examples from anywhere in the country where solicitors have provided that telephone services for some of your clients in the past as a last resort?
Well, COVID, you know, that's pretty much, you know, by telephone, by Zoom, by Teams, by, you know, services were almost exclusively provided that way. It's quite a difficult problem, really, because, and this is one of the things we need to find out working directly with survivors and staff. I feel like there's a trade-off between face-to-face and ready access to services for our more rural areas. And I'm not sure how to solve that, frankly. And we'll need to find out from survivors how to prioritize. You know, I think telephone service or video service can be delivered, as we all know now, you know, from anywhere quickly. Well, assuming there's signal, which is another issue in some of our areas. And I'm not sure I can yet accept that people living in rural and island communities should have to accept the fact that they're not going to get the same kind of service in terms of a face-to-face service that you could get in the central belt of Scotland.
So, very briefly, final question. Obviously, what you're describing there is an approach that has to be person-centred to meet the needs of particular individuals. Is that what we would aim for, no matter what, whether you be in a city, a village, or a remote rural or island setting?
I think our point is that would be what would distinguish this approach from the existing approach in Scotland services, which are not designed to provide access to justice. They're designed to tick a box.
Thank you, Dr. Scott. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks for that. I suppose following on that point about the access point, Tracy, if I could come to you, what are some of the issues that you've come across in terms of access to services and within where services are available, quality, cost, those kinds of questions? If I can come to you, and then I'll come to other witnesses.
Sure. Firstly, I'd say I wouldn't disagree with what Marcia says about there being a broader issue of how people access services. It's not just a question of consumer rights, it is a question of broadly how people access legal services, and that may come in a variety of shapes, whether it's from advice bodies or from private practice solicitors. There's actually a really limited Scottish data or research set around the consumer experience of accessing legal services, and that's something that was picked up right to the time of Roberton and hasn't really, to my mind, been resolved since that. We are currently conducting some survey work on this. We hope to be able to share results of that with the committee during the progress of the bill, but I think that probably won't be available until around the turn of the year. It is a really complex landscape for consumers, and I think the Roberton Review described it as being complex, confused, cluttered, and hard for both those within and outside the system to understand. It's probably difficult to take issue with that description. The studies that we do have, such as those by the CMA, have found significant barriers for consumers in choosing legal services, in finding information on cost, and on gauging the quality and value for money of the service they receive. The CMA also, I think, has found that there's been unmet need for legal services and low engagement by consumers in terms of being able to question whether the providers they're looking at are able to meet their needs. I know that there's been new press transparency guidance introduced by the Law Society in 2021, but I haven't yet seen any publicly available analysis of how that has impacted on the market for consumers. Like Marcia, we have a particular concern around consumers who are in vulnerable circumstances. That might be that they've got low financial resilience, they've had really difficult life events, they've got issues around their capacity to understand. People often seek legal advice when they're really stressed or when they need to spend a really significant amount of money, whether that be making bequests under a will or buying a house or criminal proceedings, for example. They're really stressful situations. If you combine that with a situation where legal professionals often have greater technical knowledge and can use very complex language, I think it's quite difficult for consumers to navigate this market in a really confident way. If you combine that with other vulnerabilities like escaping from abuse or caring or a range of other factors, that's why we think it's so important that the regulation has the ability to set very strong and appropriate standards, and that complaints based against whether a provider has met those standards can be dealt with as quickly and as easily as possible. Happy to give any more detail.
No, thanks very much, Tracy. That's helpful. In your view, the way the bill is currently drafted, do you think that we do have that capacity to set those strong regulatory standards that you are saying are so vital?
I think the regulatory objectives are far more directly set out on the face of the bill, and I think having the consumer principles there is helpful because it gives you something that you can hold things up against in terms of those consumer principles deal with issues like access, like choice. Access, to my mind, would also include affordability. So there is something there. What's important for us, I guess, as well, is that is monitored, and there is no evidence base at the moment regarding whether those principles are being met currently. And we think that it's important that our research that is ongoing at the moment will hopefully set some kind of baseline. But it's important that there is ongoing research in this market to see whether that's actually happening and whether the objectives of the reform are being met.
Thank you. Your point about the lack of data and the lack of a coherent story is well made. Sharon, if I can come to you with a similar question around the barriers around some of the challenges that people currently face and your view on how you think the bill will or won't address those challenges.
So Tracy obviously referred to some of the findings from the CMA, and I certainly echo what Tracy said about the lack of access to information, which is something that we picked up on, as you said, Robertson, as well. So we come at this from a competition and consumer protection perspective, and what I'm going to say is largely based on what we found in 2020 when we did our research. So I think the first key point, and it's one that we've already made, that there are important characteristics of legal services that affect the way in which consumers engage and are relevant for competition assessment, and that's that consumers purchase legal services infrequently and under time pressure and often in distressing circumstances, divorce, following a bereavement, and various other scenarios we've been talking about. So reliance on clear, timely information about price and quality is paramount. But what we found was that price transparency is lacking. We found we did some research with providers and found at the time only 6% of providers published prices on their website, of which, and 72% had no plans to do so, and only 18% actually had a website, and only 16% of those who had a website referred to third-party ratings. So we identified these barriers to consumers shopping around effectively, and also limited incentives on providers to compete vigorously. And the lack of transparency combined with the characteristics of legal services that I've just talked about do make it very difficult for consumers to shop around to assess quality, and that softens competition. So we found that competition wasn't working well, and I think one good way to illustrate that is we looked at the, we found very large differences in price persisting over time when we compared prices for specific scenarios on a like-for-like basis. So for example, the price for standard will may vary from about £100 to £200, obviously this is based on 2020 work. The price for an undefended divorce may vary from £300 to £925. So providers, and the combination of that with providers using different types of pricing, sometimes hourly fees, sometimes not, makes it very difficult for consumers to compare and shop around. And that analysis suggests that consumers could make significant savings if they were provided with sufficient information so they could shop around effectively. So we identified various things, various measures aimed at facilitating competition that would empower consumers by improving the availability of the information. And those recommendations were aimed at increasing transparency of price, service and quality, quality being obviously very difficult for consumers to judge, to enable them to get shop around, get a much better deal and secure good outcomes. But it's not just about price and quality, it's about improving information to enable consumers to identify their legal needs, navigate a sector that many find complex. And then also giving greater access to regulatory and provider information across the sector, which will help consumers make more informed choices, but also will offer opportunities for third parties to use this information to develop new and innovative tools for consumers, such as price comparison websites. So we made recommendations, and the Law Society had, as we've noted, published price transparency guidance. Our main recommendation to the Law Society was to evaluate whether that guidance was having an impact and driving change. And our advice was to consider turning that into a rule change, and I don't think that's happened. So we talked a little bit about the difficulty of evaluating whether or not there has been a real change in the provision of more transparent information, and if so, if that's had an impact on competition. But we also made recommendations to the Scottish Government to build on existing work. So, for example, in response to the Legal Aid Review recommendations, I think there was work at the time on developing an information hub. There was work on mygov.scot, which was all about giving information to enable consumers to navigate the market, and also measures to make regulatory data more available. And then we also recommended that Consumer Scotland, which wasn't yet established, to take on an active role in driving, delivering and monitoring information initiatives, ensuring that they're inclusive to all consumers. So that was the competition aspect of what we found. We also looked at regulation, and we recognised the importance that any regulation, and regulation is important here to protect consumer interests, but it's also important that it be proportionate to avoid unnecessary costs being passed on to consumers and to minimise any adverse impact on competition. So sometimes regulation can have the impact of inhibiting competition to the detriment of consumers. And we identified some concerns about the impact of regulation and the fact that it hadn't sufficiently kept pace with the needs of Scottish legal services sector. So we recommended a focus on removal of unnecessary regulatory restrictions on how Scottish legal service providers operate, where we felt that they might have had an adverse effect on growth, innovation and the provider's ability to compete on an equal footing. So most of our recommendations focused on implementing the ABS regime, but there were a number of other recommendations around a level playing field in professions, reducing barriers, for example, faced by commercial attorneys, also some recommendations about solicitor advocates. So that's what we did in 2020. In terms of the bill, I think there are aspects of the bill. We've talked about the objectives being set out clearly, which are positive. There are aspects of defining legal services the definition of reserved activities, all of which are important. But from our perspective, I think the thing that's important is flexibility and the ability to adapt regulation so that it isn't disproportionate, that it doesn't add unnecessary costs. So I think whilst putting things in legislation can be good, if it does so at the expense of the ability to adapt and change to changing needs, there are risks from the perspective of both competition and consumer protection.
Thanks very much. That's really helpful, and I know some of the other members will want to dig into some of those issues in a little bit more detail, particularly perhaps around ABS and some of the reserved issues. But Vicky, if I could come to you from your perspective and the consumer panel around complaints, what are the barriers or issues that come up most often around access, given the system as it currently is, and what are the likely benefits then of the bill coming in?
So one of the things that that Sharon just mentioned was around access in terms of price transparency, for example, and actually one of the things one of our panel members, Citizens Advice Scotland, provided in their briefing to the committee was some polling looking at the impact of people's consumers' perceptions of the cost of legal services on access. What they found was suggestion that in some cases consumers would be reticent about seeking legal advice if they were concerned about what the cost of that might be, either that they couldn't afford it or that it might escalate as a case continued. And I think that's something the panel would have a real concern about if there are consumers who would benefit from legal advice, who have a problem that they think might have that aspect to it, but are not seeking that because they're not confident of what the charge for that might be. That links into regulation in the sense that the consumer panel's view is that regulation should be consumer focused. It should be about supporting consumers to have access to good quality legal services, and the importance of regulation, the willingness for regulation to seek consumer input, to undertake consumer research and understand consumer views, and to act on that where that might be in conflict with the profession's interest is really important, and that's a core part of why the panel have said that the independent regulation, that's regulation that's independent from government but also from the profession that it regulates, would help to protect the consumer interest, because it would help to ensure that that's a core part of how the regulator discharges its duties.
Okay. Thanks for that. Kevin, I saw your hand, but I'm going to bring Annie in first and then I'll come to you. Annie.
Perfect. Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Some of my questions have been answered, so thank you very much for that. It saves my voice. But the thing, and Vicky had touched on it there, it's like, how would the independent regulator help consumers? And what would the role of the Lord President be if there was an independent regulator? And I think that's one of the things that I want to try and get right in my head, where the two sort of sit. And do you think it is preferable to the current system? Do you think the new bill would be preferable to the current system as well? And I'll go to Vicky first on this, because you'd sort of started to touch on it.
Sure. So I think, I guess, first of all, the panel doesn't have a kind of clear view on the role of the Lord President specifically. But I think that role of the regulator being independent, as I say, both of government and of the profession it regulates, is part of creating kind of public and consumer confidence in the regulator, and that it's taking that independent view, and that's kind of a really important part of why the panel has supported the recommendations for the single independent regulator, and that would help, I think, that regulator looking across the entire legal services market would be the best way to ensure that was discharged. As I think Tracy said earlier, the bill brings in a number of those independent aspects into the model that government is proposing. It makes for a more complex landscape, and complexity often will make it more difficult for your average member of the public, your average consumer to understand. That can lead to mistrust or misunderstanding about how the regulator acts. So a clearer model would be preferable, but certainly the independent aspects that the bill brings forwards would be welcome.
Thank you. I don't know if anyone else has got anything they want to. Tracy and then Sharon. Thanks. I think
one of the most challenging issues around a co-regulatory system is, I think, the consumer confidence angle. I know the SLCC has previously done polling on that, and I think the figures indicated that only 19% of the public thought it was acceptable for an organisation to both represent lawyers and regulate them, and only 21% were confident that a body with both functions would deal with complaints fairly. That's quite a challenging position to start from in setting out a co-regulatory regime. I think a co-regulatory system can deliver benefits if it is well designed, if it is sufficiently resourced, and if it's robustly structured. But if you don't have an independent regulator and you don't have an oversight regulator, that system does need to have some extra checks and balances mm-hmm. in it, which are some of the more controversial aspects of the bill. Now, the bill does contain a number of measures which attempt to reduce risks around transparency and address concerns about accountability, regulators having to publish reports, regulators having to be subject mm-hmm. to FOI. There are improvements on the status quo in there. We just, at the end of the day, think that independent regulation would be a cleaner, leaner system with fewer bodies. The co-regulatory system has lots of kind of multiple touch points, particularly mm-hmm. if you're a consumer. You have two organisations investing a complaint if you've got both service and conduct aspects. You have two reports. It's difficult for consumers to navigate that and understand that easily. So I guess those are the challenges from our perspective. It's not impossible to make co-regulation work, but it has to be structured in a way that allows for those checks and balances.
Thanks, Tracy. Sheridan?
Yes, so I suppose I want to start by saying, why do we say independent regulation is important? And I touched on this at the outset. I mean, we think that it's the best way to ensure that regulation can protect consumer interests, including by promoting competition among providers. We think that will lead to improved choice and innovation and also support wider public interest issues. And I mentioned that it's consistent with better regulation principles, the need for clear objectives and accountability that underpin best practice and regulation. And where you've got the same entity that represents and regulates, mm-hmm. There can be a lack of transparency about the nature of its activities. We also think there's a risk that regulatory decision-making is compromised because there are these opposing interests of the profession. And there is just a fundamental tension between the aims of the role of the regulator and the professional body, because a representative body principally seeks to promote the profession's mm-hmm. interests, whilst the regulator is looking to protect the interests of the consumer and the wider public. Mm-hmm. So to give you an example, a professional body regulating the sector is less likely to be open to business models that may increase competition from outside the profession. It may also focus on regulating quality by setting too high a bar, and that may deter competition in a way that is unhelpful for consumers and may raise costs that get passed on to consumers. So we just think there is this fundamental tension and that leads to suboptimal regulatory outcomes. And I don't think any model can remove that tension beyond a model that delivers independence. So in terms of the model that's been proposed with the regulatory committees, we don't think it will be effective because it's not substantially different from the current arrangement. Yes, there are elements that will improve matters, and we've talked a bit about transparency and accountability, Freedom of Information Act, those provisions are all helpful, but it doesn't remove the fundamental tension. And we gave examples when we did our research report of things that have happened in practice and problems with the regime the regulatory model as it currently exists. So examples where the conflict of interest may have led to the Law Society or the Faculty of Advocates prioritising the interests of members over consumers mm-hmm. in setting regulation. More generally, the fact that the regulator is subject to competing objectives, an independent regulator can set objectives in a way that's clear and more focused. The effect on regulators' regulatory incentives that may, as I've talked about, prevent or limit change that could benefit consumers. That means there's a lack of a strong voice, empowered, incentivized to drive change. And then the public trust. We talked about the SRC mm-hmm. research that showed that consumers don't have trust in the model, and that's very important as well. So I think that we think there are lots of reasons why an independent model will deliver benefits. We also considered the arguments against, because the arguments were put to us as to why this model was better, but we didn't accept those arguments. So there were arguments about a loss of professional insight and expertise, which we don't think is right. We think an independent regulator would draw on expertise. They would clearly have to draw on the expertise of the representative bodies, and would be expected to appoint professional expertise. There were arguments about costs being increased with an independent regulator model, but we don't think that's necessarily true. You can't look at costs in isolation. You need to do a net cost-benefit impact. Mm-hmm. You need to weigh up the increase in cost, the administrative cost, against the potential for significant gains for consumers from independent regulation. And we also think, you know, the various models were put forward to us. I mean, the model envisaged in the bill is an example of another model. But we just think that in order to overcome the challenges created by that tension, you have to put in place checks and balances that create complexity. And you end up pretty much in the sort of second of the options that was considered with an oversight regulator. And I think most of us agreed that that created a more complex system than was warranted and was disproportionate in a market, in the sector, the size of the sector in Scotland, and created complexity. So from our perspective, the independent regulation model is the only way to provide that, to overcome those problems, but in a way that is less complicated and less costly.
Thanks. Marcia, do you want to come in as well?
Can I just add to all of that, which is far more expert than, and I know I won't use the right language, so I apologize for that. But I also think, you know, we are well aware of the fact that what we're trying to shift is a system that is based on centuries of discrimination and disproportionate access to lack of access to justice. And I think that setting up an independent regulator, if we think about the need, for instance, of independent inspection of policing, I mean, what it essentially delivers is some kind of opportunity for us to try and level the playing field between the people who have much less power and those who have a lot of power, like the Lord President. And while I hear all of the arguments about not creating new, expensive institutions, I'm thinking about the Social Security Institution in Scotland, and because of our work on women's poverty and children's poverty, we're really well aware of the enormous differences between the way the Social Security administration in Scotland operates. And that's because they had, to a degree, a blank sheet of paper, and they were able to begin to develop processes that were person-centered, human rights-based, and which is not the tradition of the provision of Social Security in the UK more widely. I think this is an opportunity to do something similar, which is, as I was saying, we're going to pivot the system. If we can pivot the system away from the maintaining those imbalances of power and that privilege that has been so inimical to human rights for women and children experiencing domestic abuse, and create a regulatory body that's based on all the principles that these folks can cite, I'm sure, in their sleep, but that also is committed to the outcomes of improving the human rights and access to justice. And I frankly think that using a system that for centuries has denied those to try and create, with the best intentions in the world, a regulatory system of itself is just, I suppose it's the cynic in me, but it's unlikely to deliver much different and improved experiences for women and children on the ground.
Thanks, Marcia.
Thank you, panel.
Thanks. Kevin, a brief supplementary, please, before I bring Megan in.
I've got two very brief things. And I want to go back to Ms. Horowitz and her shopping around effectively comments. And, I think that we've all had experiences of finding it difficult to find a tariff for certain things. But there's also a situation where monopolies exist because of specialism. From a consumer point of view, what does that monopoly situation do to folks who are seeking advice in particularly specialist areas, do you think?
When you say monopolies, what do you have in mind? Well,
I'll give you an example, again, going back a number of years so that we don't identify anyone. But forced disposition of land, for example, which is something that doesn't happen very regularly, but folks are pushed to certain specialists who basically can charge what they like because they are the specialists. So those kind of monopoly situations, do you think that they could be ironed out to a degree with this new legislation?
I go back to what I have said before about the need to drive competition, the need to be choice for the consumers to understand what the options are when they have a particular legal problem. So I'm not sure the bill necessarily can address that, but mechanisms that will encourage the development of there's the shopping around aspect, so that consumers and the navigating the market. So there's a need for information for consumers to know when they have a legal need, what they need, what sort of service they need to resolve it. Now, if there are only a limited number of providers and it's an obscure service, there's not much that we can do to overcome that other than to ensure that regulation is set up in a way to facilitate innovation, the provision of legal services by alternative providers. One of the key aspects of our research is to enable consumers to make judgments about the use of alternative providers, sometimes unauthorised providers, depending on the nature of the service, who may be able to deliver a service that is adequate quality, but at a lower cost. So it's about having these options and about consumers understanding what is available that will drive competition.
So not wanting to put words in your mouth, but you talked about the flexibility of using regulation rather than primary legislation earlier on. Do you think that in these kind of cases, that flexibility in terms of using regulation would be helpful in terms of making adjustments where necessary to try and drive out these situations?
Yes. So, I mean, that would be where the role of an independent regulator could be quite important, because their ability to identify these areas and put in place appropriate regulation that facilitates innovation, new business models, new providers of service, and regulates a minimum, so that there's a minimum level of quality, without imposing, standards at a very high level, that makes it very difficult to encourage entry, results in regulation set at a level that's not necessarily necessary for the risk. So having targeted risk-based regulation and that flexibility to adapt, to recognise and to permit the entry of new business models is all part of that.
But, again, coming back to a point that Ms Horowitz made, but a question for Ms Crichton, is that Ms Horowitz quoted earlier Scottish Legal Complaints Commission data on certain aspects of this. In terms of gathering the data that you did you ask for the question around about trust in the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission? And if so, what were the findings of that particular question?
In that piece of research, the SLCC was asking about, I don't think there was a particular question on trust in the organisation or in other particular organisations. It was about trust in the complaints process and independent complaints processes.
I think there's a missed opportunity. I think it's grand to ask about the complaints process itself, but I think that often there's a feeling of distrust about certain organisations as well. And it would be interesting, convener, to see if there is any data on that particular subject that we could access. Thank you very much, folks. Thank you, convener.
Thanks, Kevin. I'll move on to Megan.
Thank you very much, convener, and welcome to all panel members this morning. There's been a lot of talk about the performance of regulators this morning, and if you look at the bill and it's in its current form, it would see new powers for the Scottish Government to review the performance of regulators. And some have argued that this could undermine the independence of the legal profession from the state. So I'm just interested to hear from the panel. Do you think that there is a risk that the bill could jeopardise the independence of the legal profession? And if I could start with Sharon, please.
Yes, so I think we very much, you know, we've talked a lot about independence between the regulator and the representative body, but an important, we also recognise the importance of the independence of the regulator from government. And we note, obviously, in this context that the committee received a letter last week from the Minister for Victims and Community Safety. And I did say in my opening remarks that we do also have concerns about lack of independence from the government. In our previous legal services work, we've always recognised the importance of this independence from government. An independent legal profession is important for securing various public interest considerations, such as protecting the legal rights of individuals and ensuring access to justice so that individuals can participate equally in society. But it's also important about upholding this principle that's known as the principle, the rule of law. So in principle, the judiciary, it's important to ensure that the legal sector can make decisions in the public interest free from action or perceived interference from government institutions. So I think we're definitely in agreement about the importance of maintaining independence of legal decision-making from government involvement. I think one thing that we should say is that we don't think that maintaining independence from government requires regulation, as some stakeholders suggested, requires regulation to be overseen by the existing professional bodies, and it doesn't weaken the argument for separating regulatory and representative functions. And there are many successful examples of organisations established as public bodies that effectively operate independently of government while remaining open to public scrutiny and accountability. And to give an example, I mean, the CMA is an example of that. It's perfectly possible to be subject to obligations laid on bodies by government for the provision of, to ensure transparency and accountability, to have public appointments processes and various other mechanisms without undermining that independence. So I think that we definitely think that that is an important aspect, and we also think that if the underlying model that had been chosen was a model that involved independent regulation, there would be less need for that involvement in government in the regulation of legal services.
Sorry, Megan, could you just repeat that? There's an issue with your sound.
Of course, I'm just wondering if any of the other panel members have any views on the independence from the legal profession to the state.
Thanks. And Tracy, you want to come in on this?
Very much agree with Sharon's comments. We certainly see the force of the argument that the professional body should be independent of the government and be able to voice free and frank opinions and take cases which challenge the authority of government. But we also see the need for a regulatory system that is capable of meeting the needs of consumers. And if you went for an independent regulatory model, I think our view is that these powers of intervention probably wouldn't be necessary, because that model would simply ensure, in the way it is designed, that there was that degree of separation there. I think as one of the two bodies named in the proposed powers of intervention, I think really, I don't see this power being used unless it was a last resort or a backstop, unless other approaches had been unsuccessful. And I think that the power would only be used after considering evidence and after due process, and that due process would have to include seeking and considering the views of stakeholders, including the professional bodies. I think our main concern, is, if you've read our submission, is that we're just not sure what the evidence base would be to allow us to use those powers in an appropriate way, in that if we don't have the evidence, it risks referrals to Scottish ministers being made on the basis of a limited evidence base, and that's clearly going to be open to challenge for quite right reasons. There's also a risk that we fail to make a referral simply because we don't have the evidence base, and that's interpreted as everything is fine, whereas in fact we don't necessarily think everything is fine, but we don't have the evidence to say otherwise. So again, it goes back to the point I was making earlier, that we need to be clear about what evidence we need to underpin these powers, who's responsible for producing it. Yeah, there are bits of evidence that could be used. I know that, an example, other jurisdictions' regulators have access to and can publish aggregate first-tier complaints data, so the data that actually the firms themselves are seeing. If you combine that with the data from regulators, you could get a much richer picture about what areas are generating complaints, what's problematic. You could look at the type of tracker surveys that the Legal Services Board runs, which we've got one in the field at the moment, and you'd also be looking at stakeholder views. So in terms of what you'd need to exercise those powers, yeah, it might well be that the regulatory committees themselves are raising issues saying we don't think this is working. But I recognise that these powers have attracted a very strong comment. I guess my fear is if you take these powers out of the bill in their entirety, what then do you do if in 3 years' time, in 5 years' time, in 10 years' time, you decide that the system isn't delivering on the regulatory objectives? Are you then stuck with only having primary legislation as the way to correct that, which I think goes back to the point that Mr. Stewart was making around, you know, is there sufficient flexibility within the regime to be able to adapt to changing circumstances and challenges that we might not be able to see right now?
Thanks, Tracy. Megan, back to you.
It's on the point that Tracy...
Sorry, Megan, we're having a couple of issues with your sound. Can you stop that again? Thank you.
Sorry, convener. It was on the point that Tracy mentioned there about the from the bill, it's not clear what evidence they would need to recommend to Scottish Government ministers. So in terms of that, do you think that could be an additional administrative burden that's been put on people in order to come up with that evidence? You said as well, Tracy, that it's not clear cut exactly what evidence would be required, and therefore it could be ineffective if you don't have the right evidence for this to be taken further. So I'm just wondering if you'd maybe be able to expand a little bit more on that.
Sure. I think first, it's not clear who that responsibility of producing evidence would sit with. If it was to be Consumer Scotland, then I think we'd want to be confident that resource was in place to deliver that. We have got models that would provide a precedent for that. We get, for example, dedicated funding across the markets of energy, post and water that is levy generated, that allows us to work in a lot of detail on an ongoing basis on those markets. When it comes to our other work, we work across a large variety of sectors. It could be housing, finance, general consumer protection issues. For us, if we were required to work in the legal services market on an ongoing, yearly, absolutely regular basis to produce that evidence, that would inevitably diminish the extent of resource that was available to work right across those other sectors as well. So there is a risk that, you know, by having to concentrate our efforts in one area, that would reduce our effectiveness potentially across other areas.
Okay. Thanks. Megan, anything else from you?
No, convener, thank you.
Sure. Okay. Thanks, Megan. Over to you, Fulton.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. There's two areas I'd like to explore, and the first is on this part of the bill which proposes to make it an offence to use the title of lawyer where there's an intent to deceive in connection with providing legal services. I'm just really looking for comments on that, as this is our first evidence session, to see where people stand in that, and I suppose by, you know, association, if you could also talk about if you do think that there's any risks for regulating the title which might unduly restrict the work of other unregulated lawyers such as paralegals, legal academics, etc. So just really looking for a broad view on where you stand in this particular provision just now. I'm quite happy to go in any order.
Sharon, do you want to kick us off? And
so we do have views on title regulation, and that's based on the legal services work that we've done over time. So professional titles have the potential to affect consumer decision-making. And we've talked some about the inherent difficulties that consumers and legal services face in observing quality directly. And consumers do sometimes rely on titles like solicitors when navigating the market, and they use that as an indicator of quality. And although that can be a useful and practical way to help consumers at least find an indication of minimum level quality, we have concerns because it also has the potential to limit the scope for competition, and that has a consequence in terms of affordability because it may result in consumers avoiding, for example, unauthorised providers completely, regardless of the level of quality
and consumer protection that these providers may offer, and regardless of the value of for money that could be obtained by the consumer by using these alternatives. And so this may result in a barrier to entry for other providers. So far as concerns the bill proposals to protect the term lawyer, you know, we note that they are designed to address a legitimate concern that, that consumers may assume that the term lawyer means the provider is subject to regulation and might end up choosing an unauthorised provider willingly without understanding the consequences. But we don't think that's necessarily the case. And I've already talked about the unintended negative consequences on competition. If it makes it harder for unauthorised providers to use these alternatives, even in situations when they might benefit from using them. So in our view, whilst we understand some that there is a legitimate concern, we equally don't think, or at least it hasn't been presented to us, any compelling evidence of the detriment suffered by consumers because the term lawyer is not regulated, or advocate or other titles, because they're not currently protected. And we go back to what we said before about the need for regulation to be proportionate and targeted to risk. So we would advise that there should be additional evidence of the detriment be gathered before introducing this additional requirement.
Has anybody else got any views on that, or are they shared? Yep, excellent. Okay, thanks very much. That was good. The other area that I'd like to ask about is the provisions in the bill around about alternative business structures. And again, I'm really just looking for a very broad discussion-based kind of response to what your thoughts are on the bill's proposals to liberalise ABSs and what impact you think this might have on consumer practice.
Just a general point on that. So I think Sharon just mentioned, you know, the need for regulation to help to improve access and choice for consumers, so to make it possible for a consumer to find the legal advice or representation that they're looking for, and in a number of different places where that's appropriate. And so we think that from the panel's perspective, in general terms, anything that improves that choice and access is helpful. The proposals on alternative business structures have been on the statute books for a long time now, but are not available for consumers to be able to use currently. So proposals to, but they've been operating, for example, in England and Wales for many years, as far as we're aware, without issue. So being able to make that work now as part of this legislation would be welcome.
Okay, thanks. And a follow-up question, maybe for Marsha or for MD, actually, but I know Marsha might want to come in on it. The bill also removes the requirement, that ABSs have to provide services for a fee, gain or reward. And do you think this could open up opportunities for law centres or charities such as yourself, to become ABS, is that something you think about a bit too early on to be thinking about that?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, at the beginning, I spoke about how much in favour we are of removing the restrictions on organisations like ourselves that provide advocacy and advice. Per the recommendations that Martin Evans had in his independent review of legal aid in Scotland, we really welcome, expanding the ability of law centres, of other organisations to meet the what is rather extraordinarily large unmet need, so that that's very welcome. I think that we would also like to just point out that there's some language around only allowing employment of those employed full time on a fixed salary, and having a solicitor on a fixed salary is a real advantage in our setting. It allows us to attract solicitors who will have a who are interested in providing sort of essentially public sector kinds of services, and less interested in a high profit margin. But also, we also work in an environment where it's very likely to need to be family friendly for employees, and that we, you know, our model in Edinburgh, for instance, is a combination of paralegals and part-time solicitors, which accommodates the need for women solicitors, as well as expanding the flexibility of provision. So we would need to make sure that however the final wording of the law is, that it accommodates that flexibility.
Okay, thank you.
Briefly. Oh, yeah. By way of follow-up, I would agree with what's been said. We support the proposals because we think that the ABS proposals are likely to improve access ultimately for consumers, especially in areas which are maybe less well served by private practice providers. It should, if you know, the policy intent is carried through, increase the choice of providers available. It should enhance the range of services available. And more generally, just improve levels of competition and innovation. I'm not sure that we see a strong case for the retention of a 10% ownership requirement by legal professionals when it comes to ABS structures. Sharon may have comments on that in a moment. I think just my final point on this would be that there are a number of proposals which will have an impact in the area of access to justice. These proposals, the legal aid proposals, the Human Rights Act proposals that Masha referred to before, which take a very advocacy-based approach to accessing human rights. There's probably just a need still for a little bit of joined-up thinking about how that will work from the perspective of consumers or people who are accessing those services, just to make sure that everything is joined up effectively. I don't know whether Masha would want to...
Actually, that I was trying to figure out how to shoehorn in a comment that that I have in my briefing. So that was a great opportunity. Thank you. Which is, we're quite concerned that there's a real lack of commitment to development, consultation with service users and survivors in the development of new services or new regulatory bodies or any of the mostly welcome innovations that are proposed in the legislation, and that's one of the ways that you provide that joined up thinking, because we were talking before about the patchwork of legal services, civil legal services available for women and children experiencing domestic abuse. And it can be everything from negotiating a divorce to a settlement on a house to child contact and custody arrangements, to a whole variety of things. And those reflect, the real experiences of people who need services rather than the way the services are designed and delivered. And it's that kind of input that helps us see the system as a whole and join it up as best we can. I've now shoehorned that in, but I do think it's relevant to looking across to making sure that the actions in this law actually further some of the positive arrangements that we're trying to make in other changes in the system too.
Thanks, Marcia. Sharon.
Yes. No, I mean that we consider ABSs can have really positive impacts for consumers. We've talked to everyone else has commented on their potential to stimulate competition and innovation. We've been making the point about the need to implement the ABS regime ever since we did our research report. And we're concerned that there haven't yet been ABSs. There are some really significant benefits we think that can result from ABSs in terms of access to external capital, the ability to achieve efficiencies by exploiting economies of scale, the ability to retain high-performing non-sister employees or attract outside talent, the involvement of non-legally qualified professionals, practitioners in management that could facilitate entry of more business-oriented firms, the ability to deal with exit, entry and exit, allowing partners in small firms who wish to retire opportunities to transfer ownership. So it's for all these reasons we think ABS is really important. And indeed, in our research report, we found evidence that the lack of ABSs had impeded entry, growth and innovation, but it also affected the wider competitiveness of the Scottish legal services sector. For example, with the result that Scottish firms may have not been able to compete on a level playing field with English-based firms. So for all those reasons, we think it's really imperative that the ABS model does develop. In terms of the ownership threshold, yes, we do have views. We raised concerns in our research report about the 51% ownership threshold, and it's clearly an improvement that it's the proposal in the bill is to reduce it to 10%. We think that the ownership threshold is a barrier to participation in ABS schemes, and that it might limit the introduction of ABSs. We think that it will create a competitive disadvantage for Scottish law firms relative to their counterparts in England and Wales, where there's no minimum threshold, ownership threshold. And we think that there aren't risks. We don't think that there are. We think the risks are extremely low associated with the relaxation. And so for those reasons, we query the value of there being any ownership threshold.
Interrupt there. Is that what you mean in the response around that entity regulation potentially going too far and kicking in even if people are practitioners but not owners? Is that what that bit of your written submission gets at?
About entity regulation?
Yeah.
So I think you may be referring to the... We made a point about entity regulation, which I think was a mistaken understanding of what the bill... So, if from recollection, we had some concerns... So this is a different concern.
Okay.
This is about the 10%, having a requirement for legal ownership.
Right.
Which we don't think is necessary. That the entity... We can come on to that.
Okay. So, sorry for... taking you off your flow there. We think that
having this ownership requirement could limit the introduction of novel business models, and it might end up limiting ABSs to simply having an additional non-sister partner added to a firm, so keeping very traditional firm structures and not getting these new models. So we think we would recommend removing the ownership threshold completely. As regards the proposed removal of fee gain or reward requirement, we welcome that. We think it's important to allow third sector organisations to directly employ legal professionals to undertake reserved activities. So we think that's a good thing. And indeed, when we did our research report, we identified various difficulties that had been encountered because of the lack of ABSs. So, for example, people had found workarounds, and we found evidence that law centres and other social enterprises were partnering with senior solicitors in order to provide legal services. And that created an additional risk that wouldn't arise if the solicitor was part of the enterprise and had greater control over the work that it carried out. We also had concerns about law centres losing access to client files if they were relying on external legal advice. And we also noted some SLCC findings that social enterprises, many of which are currently registered in England and Wales, were interested in operating in Scotland, but through the difficulties of doing so hadn't entered. So for all those reasons, we think that's a really good thing. The final point that we've made, and we have made consistently, is that we think that there would be benefits to Scottish consumers from removing restrictions on advocates forming partnerships, whether with other advocates or in ABSs with legal and or non-legal professionals, and the ability to accept instructions directly from consumers should they choose to do so. And we think that that would create efficiencies in streamlining of processes. And it's, again, one of the other aspects that we've previously recommended.
Karen, sorry for interrupting, Fulton. Is that you?
I think we've got quite a lot there for the record.
Super. Thank you. There are just two areas I want to pick up on, and my apologies for confusing the entity regulation with that ownership point. Could you just unpack that a little bit? Because in your written statement, you say that Section 39 could kick in even if solicitors are involved in legal business but aren't actually owners, and therefore the entity regulation perhaps goes too far. Could you just unpick that a little bit for me?
So let me deal with entity regulation and then I'll come on to that particular point. So I think our starting point is that legal service regulation imposes regulatory costs on providers and regulators. And because those costs are ultimately passed to consumers, it's important that when you impose regulatory framework, it's on the basis of an impact assessment that balances the benefit of regulation against the costs. So for us, we welcome the model that involves entity regulation and individual regulation, and it's important to strike the right balance. So as a general rule, where you have individual-based regulation, that's often necessary when there are high risks that are identified that can only be addressed by ensuring the individual is competent to provide the service and should be personally responsible. And then there are, when there are not such high risks, then entity-based regulation, where entities can set the necessary obligations on employees, can be more proportionate. And so I think we welcome the introduction of entity regulation, but we are concerned that the judgment about whether it should be entity regulation or individual regulation should be based on an assessment of market failure and where it's appropriate to use that. Now, the point that I think you may be referring to is that we talked a little bit about... I'm finding my response because we had some concerns, if you bear with me, that we highlighted. That where there's a requirement that all licensed professionals should also be licensed through an entity, that was the concern. So we were concerned that that would restrict entities. The entities within which certain professional titles could be employed. So that would mean that solicitors, for example, would be restricted in working in unlicensed providers, even when they were carrying out unreserved legal activities. But I think we had a discussion with the Scottish Government, and that isn't. We were concerned that that's what the bill intended, but we understand that isn't the case.
Thank you for that clarification. Kevin, did you want to come in on this? And then I've got one final question around
it's
complaints.
It's a separate matter, so if you want to continue, I've just got the one thing, which is different.
Vicky, if I can come back to you. Obviously, we want the complaint system to be robust and to be effective, but we want things to be in place so we don't get there. But I suppose when we do get to the complaint system, could you just say a little bit more about how the bill's proposals, I suppose specifically to extend SLCC's powers to investigate complaints, how to unregulated legal service providers, how the consumer panel views that, or what the views on what rigour that will bring to the complaints process?
Sure. So I think that the panel certainly has raised concerns around the existing complaints process in terms of its complexity, in terms of the time it can take, and how clear it is to consumers how to access and how that process will a complaints process will take place. So it's certainly something that that the panel certainly welcomed the provisions in the bill to look at making the complaints process more streamlined, as far as those go. In terms of the extending the complaints process to unregulated legal services, that certainly could help, as we've touched on in a number of other areas. It could help to encourage consumers to have more choice across the market, to use the most appropriate provider, and to do that with the knowledge that there will be a basic level of consumer protection available, albeit that would be different to existing regulated providers. The panel has said that it's concerned to ensure that proposal doesn't limit access to that free to particularly to free advice and sort of place unnecessary additional burden on providers, again, particularly not-for-profit providers, but certainly at the level of allowing a complaint to be brought where someone has used a legal service that is currently unregulated, that would be that would be very welcome. I think the other aspect that the panel's particularly concerned about is that, as you say, you know, you hope you don't get to that point, but you want the complaints process to work when you need it. I think it's also the case that when people are raising a complaint, they're both looking for it to that issue to be resolved for themselves, but they're often also saying that they want the issue to be understood so it doesn't happen again in future. So the panel is absolutely supportive of the proposals in the bill for the whole regulatory system, drawing on that learning from complaints to become much better at understanding where those risks exist, and to looking to build on those as part of continuous improvement to avoid the same issues arising in future. So that's a particularly welcome aspect of the bill.
Okay, thank you. That's really helpful. Kevin.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd like to go back to a point that Dr. Scott made earlier around about maybe a lack of voices of lived experience in terms of some of the work that has been carried out thus far. I wonder if Dr. Scott would like to comment around about what we should be doing, government should be doing, in terms of gathering up the views of those voices of lived experience when it comes to setting regulations, or in terms of the flexibility of going back and revisiting these regulations at a later point. How do you think we best access those voices of lived experience, including many of the women who you have advocated for over many years?
I think it needs to be an and model, not an or model. So how is it that we, how do we improve our existing systems and embed in any new systems co-design elements? We have a survivors reference group. Rape Crisis Scotland has a survivors reference group. And I was very struck by what was just said about people getting involved in complaints processes, not because it's going to change the injustice of what happened to them, but to improve the system for others. And that is absolutely what we hear from survivors all the time. And yet their expertise is so rarely embedded in the process of examining, inspecting, and changing and improving the system. So one of the things that we would very much like to see, and also this comes back to data, you know, just to the original point about data. And, you know, I think there's a lot of notion that somehow numbers are objective, and yet actually that is never the case. No data is objective. It's always collected with certain kinds of assumptions. They just need to be they need to be explicit and transparent. I think that the way to engage with those with lived experience, which I have to say in Scotland is, you know, approximately 1 out of 3 to 1 out of 4 women, and probably 1 out of 5 children have experience of domestic abuse. So this is not a small task, but it's also a readily available pool of information. And so when we're talking about good data collection, for instance, one of the things we need to do is it needs to be equalities informed. It needs to be looked at, and when you set up a system for data collection that is scrutinized by people with lived experience who will tell you what are the things you're not asking that you should be, or you are asking that are couched in ways that will limit the robustness of what you're getting. So that's all very vague, but what it circles back to for me is looking at every system that we set up and trying to identify best case scenario, a co-design approach. And if you can't do co-design, then accountability mechanisms that absolutely engage with survivors of domestic abuse, with, you know, consumers of all of the services.
Design like Social Security Scotland, which made that a much better system.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much, Kevin. Thank you all for your contributions today and for the written evidence that you had provided in advance. We've covered an awful lot of ground, and if there are things that you think actually, you know, I could give more evidence or more information on this, please do send us further communication. We'll be looking at this bill for the coming weeks when we're not looking at the UNCRC incorporation as well. So that's going to be an interesting and mixed few weeks for us. But that concludes our formal business for today's meeting. Marsha, was that I've got one last thing to say.
Yeah, just one. Again, shoehorning, but the CRC reference was really helpful in the sense that the one thing that I just hadn't really included was the invisibility of children and young people who have a statutory right to legal services in Scotland in certain many circumstances. Hardly ever do they have access to that right. Hardly ever are they engaged in discussions about what it would look like if they did have access. So I would say that, and clearly with CRC, UNCRC, we're looking at how we can improve Scotland's provision of access to human rights for children and young people. And those questions are really relevant for this bill. So as we go forward, it would be really, really important, I think, to ring fence some activity with children and young people, either in the design and consultation processes, not either, but also in those, mm-hmm. but also a very specific specialist look at how these services do or don't affect children and young people. Kate Tisdall would be a great person at the University of Edinburgh to bring in and to engage with us, I think, on that stuff.
Okay. Thanks for that, Marsha. Sharon, you had another point you wanted to raise.
If you don't mind, make one additional point. So building on what you say about lived experience and data, and that I completely agree with that, and lack of data was something that lack of research evidence and data was something we discovered in our report. But I want to pick up on something that Tracy said about in response to the question about the checks and balances that are envisaged, the role that's been given to the CMA and the Consumer Scotland and the Parliament, because we talked about what the evidence base will be. But for me, the concern is that the evidence base won't come from consumers, and that's what Consumer Scotland, I suspect, is well set up for, because the sort of, when we're talking about the operation of the regulatory framework, and that particularly the things that we're concerned about, so the tension between the representative regulatory body, that's not going to come from consumers. We'll get evidence from consumers about lack of confidence in the system, but the sort of the ability to identify problems, and we discovered that. I mean, most of our examples came from the SLC when we looked at the operation of the we looked at the conflicts of interest and the problems that have arisen in the current model. So I think the point we want to make about the role that's been entrusted is that actually in order to perform that role, you really effectively have to be a regulator and have that sort of relationship with the bodies, because we don't think that the evidence will be readily available from, for example, consumers.
Thanks, Sharon. That's a helpful point. I'm going to ask Tracy and Vicky if there's any last points that you want to make. No. Okay.
Right, we will end there then. Thank you all for your comments. That concludes our formal business for today, and we will now move into private to consider our last couple of items on our agenda. Thank you.